Okay, we're recording now. So this is the first in a series. And so in this series, we're going to go specifically over these content types. But we encourage you to check out the LT and ITC calendar and what remains for this semester. And then keep on the lookout for next semester when we start adding more of these series. We're hoping to do maybe two a semester, but we're still working the logistics of that. But they are forthcoming. So a couple of tips we want to start with about logging into H5P. You can always access H5P through D2L. However, you can go to h5p.com and choose the login button in the top right corner and enter your MTSU email address, and it should log you in because it's all connected, single sign-on, as long as you've already created that account. And so that's kind of where I'm going to start. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen now and kind of walk through, we're going to start walking through this process. So this is the h5p.com screen. And excuse me, I'm sorry. This is where you can log in directly right up here and type in that email address, and it's going to take you to h5p.com, and it will look, when you log in, something like this. It's going to have your content. H5P is a file folder based system. So you would want to think about saving things as you create them in H5P in an organized way for you to know the purpose of the things that you create. So we recommend, you don't have to do this, but we recommend whatever you create, have a base folder with your name on it. So that if you need assistance from an admin with H5P, whether it's one of the online instructional designers or Scott Hopp, we know where your stuff is immediately because it's by your name and we know it's your content. And then within that, organized by course that you would be using it in. You can also organize by type, but sometimes that can get a little confusing because you don't necessarily know where you want to use that content if you just have 10 accordions and where you put them. So we really recommend organizing by course. So as you can see in mine, this is what mine looks like. I'm only looking at my content because I can see everyone's content. Because of my permissions. So, but this is the file folders that I have set up for me that I have used for various courses that I've created content in. So that's just a little sidebar about thinking about how you want to organize your content to be able to find it. So we're going to start with accordions. Is everybody good on how to thinking about how to organize content? Any questions before we just dive in? Okay, and please feel free to use the chat. Kim and Karen are manning chat, so you can type any questions there or unmute and just interrupt me. That's totally fine because this really is meant to be a practical-based workshop. So we're gonna start with accordions. This is what an accordion looks like when it's done. This is kind of how I'm gonna show you what it looks like, and then we're gonna go in and create one together. But this is what accordion is, and I'm starting with accordion for a couple of reasons. One, it's pretty easy to create. Two, we're all familiar with accordions because they're often used on web pages. And three, there's all kinds of creative ways you can use accordions within your course. It is not an assessment. It really is meant to be an activity or an interaction with content. So it's not something that you tie to the grade book. But to create an accordion, you would go in and you'd say, I want to add new content. This gives me this every time because my content is shared. You won't necessarily get that notification. And as it loads, I like to sort from A to Z. That's just me. Accordion's always at the top. You would select accordion and it's gonna ask you to start building. So I really encourage you to turn your cameras off and go jump in somewhere and start building stuff as we talk through this process, because that's what it's really meant to be, this hands-on on workshop. I will not be offended if your camera is not on. So this is where you start, and I'm gonna jump back to mine that is already completed and filled out so that I can kind of walk you through the steps with the information already filled out. Okay, so you wanna give your your accordion a name, a title, so that if you want to search for it later or have reports about something, you're able to find it. So that's why I've made, literally accordion template, H5P series one. It's very clear to me. I know the purpose of this particular accordion. So that's why I named it according to that title. And then underneath here, panels are the panels that you're going to set up for your dropdown. So of course, each panel has to have a title and it has to have text associated with it. So you type right in there, whatever you want your title for that first panel to be, and then you type in your text. And as you can see, it's dynamic. So you can center it, you can bold it, you can change colors, you can make it bigger. You can do all kinds of things within this text box for your accordion for this particular panel. A couple of things I want to mention. I know sometimes faculty shy away from using color because you're worried about accessibility. You can use color. You don't want to use an overabundance of color, but you certainly can use color as long as the color fits within those guidelines for contrast, which this will tell you when you check it, if it does or doesn't. But then also too, you don't want to just use color to as the sole way of conveying information. So you want to think about having color and then bold or color and then italicized so that it conveys information in two ways for screen readers. You really want to shy away from underlining. For accessibility reasons, underlining should only be used for hyperlinks. So you go in and you input your panel information and you continue to add panels. This had three panels by clicking the add panel button. So think about when you're thinking about what you might use an accordion for, think about ahead of time, how many panels do you think you want? You don't want to have an overabundance of panels because then you're almost not achieving the goal, what you were trying to hopefully achieve, which was chunking information. So really think about, is it steps in a process? Is it steps to an assignment? Is it a introduction to a module? Think about the ways that you might be able to use accordions to present information and thinking about how many panels. We recommend really not having any more than 5 or 6 panels. Again, unless it's specific to something like steps in a process that has more than that many steps, et cetera. And then I'm going to go over this information down here the first time because this information at the bottom is the same starting right here for every tool. So I'm going to kind of walk through this the first time around. As far as this H2 tags for labels, this is the accessibility portion. We truly recommend when it comes to accessibility because the things are built into these tools that you just leave the settings. Because if you change the settings, it's going to change the accessibility. And chances are you don't need to change those settings. So when it comes to things regarding accessibility, we ask that you just leave them unless we need to talk through it. So going down to display options, toolbar below content. That means for students, if there's a toolbar associated with this particular content tool, that toolbar is going to be below that content rather than above. Allow users to download content. That is completely up to you. Usually I don't have that box checked because I don't necessarily want students to be able to download it because they can do everything within D2L directly. Display the embed button. This is only available for public content. We're going to talk about what that means in a second. And you, unless you just want to publish your content to everyone in H5P, leave that button blank. Display copyright button. Do you want your information itself copyrighted or is there something, maybe an image into which you want to add the copyright? Again, that's really up to you and the purposes of what you're using the accordion for. And this display confusion indicator, this is actually something new. And if you check this box, it's going to have a little tiny thing that says confusion or I'm confused on the accordion that students can then click on to give you feedback about what they're confused about. Now, this feedback is going to go to the owner of whoever creates the content or the owner and the collaborators. So as a faculty member, when you are creating content, you are the owner of that content. And you're the only one that owns that content unless you decide to assign additional collaborators here. You're not assigning additional collaborators here. This is where you can change. So this confusion report can go to other collaborators. Maybe they're confused about the content or maybe they're confused about the tool. So that's really up to you. And then they can leave this anonymously if you check this box. So this is something that's actually recently added. to H5P, so I haven't had as much time to play with it. So we're going to play with it a little bit here in this workshop because that's what the workshop's for. Any questions about these before I go on to the next things? Okay, under publish, you have unpublish option, which means the content cannot be inserted into the LMS. This is not an option you want to choose because you want your students to be able to see it in the LMS. Protected means the content can be inserted into the LMS, but it's protected in that it doesn't go to the world. It only goes to the content or to the course in which you posted that particular link or that particular embedded that particular link. And then public, if you want everyone to be able to see it and it can be inserted into an LMS and embedded. Again, we don't recommend public unless you just want to make your content public because this is an OER in that you can share and collaborate with others. But again, that's up to you and what you decide you want to do. So for most purposes, you always want to pick protected. Folder, what folder are you keeping it in? Right. So remember, I have access to everybody's folders. So think about what folder you're keeping it in. That's what this is for. So you can choose the folder that you're saving in. Collaborators are where you can assign those other individuals to particular content activities. So if you want to collaborate with someone, you can. So for example, right now I'm the owner. I'm currently collaborating with Karen. So she can access my content at any time. And if I want to add someone, I just have to type in their name, and because it's single sign-on, it's like, yes, I want to add Kim Godwin. So I click her, and now all of a sudden she's also available to edit content if she so chooses. And then if I don't want someone or I accidentally pick someone, I can just go, just kidding, and kick them out. So that's how you add collaborators. This might be helpful if, for example, you are working on a gen ed class that's a 10, 10, 10, 20 that has a lot of foundational information. You might want to collaborate with other faculty in your department. So instead of having Word docs or PDFs of key terms with definitions, you collaborate together to make dialogue cards that you then insert in each other's classes as it relates to 10, 10 to 10, 20. And it's an experience that the student will have in both classes. That might be a way you would think about wanting to collaborate with others. Share with the organization. Again, this is up to you. Do you want to share to the entire organization or do you don't? At this point, we really recommend not until you're ready. And then LTI settings. This maximum width box has to do with the dynamic feature of H5P. It is dynamic, meaning it doesn't matter if they look on a cell phone, if they look on a tablet, if they're looking on a desktop, it's going to be fluid. That screen size is going to be fluid so that the student has the same experience regardless of the screen size they're looking at. If you put information in this box, which on occasion you do when having to create more complicated H5P content, then we'd need to enter some information here. But for the purposes of all the tools that we're looking at right now, and most of the tools actually within H5P, leave this blank. Then lastly, when to send scores to an LMS. The default is to not send a score to the LMS. This is purposeful because we learned the hard way when we actually had the default the opposite way that that was not good. So the default is to not send a score, but you can send a score for first attempt, last attempt, or best attempt. But we are really hoping that you will look at these tools and as activities for students to engage in rather than summative assessments, at least particularly for the tools that we're covering today. A couple of them can be used as assessments, but we're going to show you a way to see what students are doing and get those results without actually having to tie it to the gradebook. So these settings are the same on every single tool for the most part. So that's why I wanted to go over them the first time. I'm not going to go over them again. So if you have questions, what might they be? Go ahead and feel free to ask questions. Are there any questions in chat? I've got to be honest. I see the chat going crazy, but I haven't had a chance to look at it.
It was mostly questions about logging in.
Gotcha.
I think we've gotten most of those, but most of the questions were about logging in.
Awesome.
To begin with. So,
any other questions? Does anybody want to jump in? Just unmute yourself if you have a question. Okay. So, that is how you build an accordion. So I'm going to give you a couple minutes. Hopefully, maybe you were even building while I was talking, potentially. But I want to give you a couple minutes to take the opportunity to build an accordion. The biggest thing to remember when you're building Don't forget to hit the save button when you're done. Otherwise, well, it doesn't save and you've wasted your time. So, and this is what it looks like in the end. Now, again, these are real short for the purposes of the template. I would not necessarily, if I only have one sentence, I'm not going to create an accordion for that, because you really have to think about when it comes to tools and technology, you don't want to use something just for the sake of using something. You really want to think about, is this tool the best way to convey or communicate this information, or to elicit the response I'm looking for, or to meet whatever goal it is that you have for your students to meet? So I wouldn't necessarily create an accordion with one sentence, but in the interest of time, that's what I did here. And as you can see, right, what are our outcomes for this particular module? What are our outcomes for the series objectives? What are our series objectives? So these are the things that you can do. So I encourage you, I'm going to give you a couple minutes. It's going to kind of be quiet time for y'all to be able to build something. And then if you have questions while you're building, jump in and ask me. Or if you want to talk about ideas that you have and ways that you could use accordions in your course, share with us so we could talk about those ways that they could be incorporated. I did want to show you right here is that little thing that says, I am confused. So you can send a question to the author. And this is where a student can literally say, I don't understand, please help me, and submit feedback to you that will go to, again, either the owner, you, or the owner and collaborator, depending on what you decided when you checked that box at the bottom. You don't have to have the I am confused option. You could turn that off. We just want to make sure that you can see it and what it looks like for the student. So I'm going to give y'all a couple minutes now. It's going to be a little weird sitting here quiet, but go ahead and create something. And I can't wait to hear a couple things. I'm going to give us 2 or 3 minutes. And please ask questions if you have questions.
Tara?
Yes.
I think a lot of us are a little confused because we came not knowing even what this was. And I'm totally lost. I just now logged in, but like you've gone, so I don't know where to go from here. And several people have expressed that they don't.
This is actually, we did an introductory workshop to H5P in September. So this is kind of a continuation of that workshop where we introduced what H5P was. And then this is a series of workshops, which is why that focus on very specific content tools being used or that can be used in H5P. So we're focusing on, in these workshop series, building practical tools throughout the hour of the workshop to then talk about and have that experience and what you might use them for.
I didn't understand, so I'm sorry. So I will.
No, that's okay.
I will log out, and when you come back around to some sort of introduction course, I'll start over.
Introduction course is currently on our MTSU Online channel. So if you at any time want to go out there and watch it, it's available for you when you have time to see it as well.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Hi, Tara. This is Todd. I came in late. Could you send me the link to the tool?
Yes.
Thank you.
Hey, Todd, if you just log into D2L.
Oh, yeah.
And then click on the insert stuff in either create a file or any description box, okay. It will automatically log you in.
Okay.
So Tara, I have a question.
Yes.
So when I'm logging in, I see nothing in mine because I haven't created anything yet.
Correct.
One thing I think that would be really helpful, I don't know if this is possible, but does H5P have any like examples that we could bring into our folder and then look at the examples and use those to help us build new?
H5P has demos of how to create content, but what I am going to do is for everyone who registered for the workshop, I'm going to make these templates public to everyone who attended so that you have templates to start with when you go back in.
So they won't be in our folder, but there's a folder we can access that can then we can copy from those templates to our folder.
Yes, and I'm going to talk about how you can copy, how you can clone, how you can move. I just haven't gotten quite there yet, but we're going to talk about that also.
Awesome. Thank you, Tara.
You're welcome.
With me.
All right, so it's been a couple minutes and I know we have things to go through. So was anyone able to create an accordion or willing to share their accordion? You can share your screen, actually. You have capability to do that, or are willing to say, hey, this is what I was thinking of using it for. And then we'll move on to the next thing.
So Tara, one of the things I thought about using this for in my gen ed class is even just that first module where it's all the requirements for like the syllabus and the projects that go along, you know, and I have in D2L folders for, you know, like the syllabus, but the assignment, but I thought making some interactive activities that would make sure that they had read things, you know, because you always get right here at this point in the semester, I'm getting all the, I didn't know I had a research report that was due, even though the title of the folder is last day to turn in research report is November 22nd, you know, that kind of thing. So I thought about using some of this that way. And so that's kind of how I've started the accordion, just kind of like module one, which is always all my background information, and then maybe having some, and then I've got like syllabus assignment review where I'm going to maybe put in some kind of interactive activity where they, you know, what day are my office hours and, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah.
Right. That's really exciting. We're actually hoping way in the future, because it's a more complicated thing to create an interactive syllabus virtual escape room. So we can do something fun like that. So students still have to do a syllabus quiz, but they're escaping. And I did, so everyone can see, I actually did work on a course that did that for their descriptions for modules and for their overview. So they did write their overview using the accordion. They, whenever students log in with the learning outcomes and course modules, and then just to show one in the middle, this is what the introduction to each of her modules looks like. She wanted text specifically first to introduce that module and then have the module outcomes, how they relate to the course objectives, and then the recommended order of completion for the module. So just to give you an idea of how that could be used. So we are going to jump into the next thing, which is fill in the blank. This one's really pretty easy. I wanted to show you fill in the blank because you can do it in two ways. You can either type in the missing words and it's a fill in the blank in that way, or you can actually use images within fill in the blank also. So to create a fill in the blank, just like you did before, it would be new content. And then you would choose the fill in the blank option. And when it pulls up, it's going to look like this. It will have the type in the missing words description, or actually it'll say fill in the missing words. We recommend saying type in the missing words. For some reason, to fill can be a little confusing. The individuals can look for items to literally fill in the words instead of typing them in. So type in the missing words. And then you add text blocks in asterisks to designate what that blank is. So Tallahassee is the capital of Florida, Atlanta is the capital of Georgia, Montgomery is the capital of Alabama. Each of those capitals have asterisks around them. So that is the blank. For these as well, you can hit this little show instructions and it's going to give you step by step on how to do that and remember what to do. So that's helpful. And you just add continual text blocks depending on how many lines you want in the fill in the blank. This one has three. Here, where it talks about overall feedback, this is where you want to think about what kind of feedback you want to give to students if you want to give feedback about this particular exercise. So, for example, if you want to use fill in the blank after they have watched a 10-minute lecture video that then you know you want them to go back through and think about and take notes on and have answer fill in the blank questions about that lecture video, you can do that and then say, okay, if you get zero to, we're going to say 50%, right? If you get zero to 50%, well, that's not necessarily really good, depending on how many questions you've asked. So you might want to say, hey, go back and review the video and try again. Or if they get to, you know, 90, if you want to choose 90 to 100%, they've done really well. You've done great. Thanks for engaging in this particular thing. Let me know if you have any questions. So you really can think about the generic feedback you want to give for certain ranges of scores. You can do any kind of ranges that you want, just where it says add range. And you can also distribute evenly just by clicking this button. So it's really up to you what you want to do. Within behavioral settings, this is the kind of things really that you want to think about, the decisions you want to make for why you're using this particular tool. So do you want them to be able to retry? Do you want them to see a show solution button so they can click a button and it'll tell them what the answer is? Do you want them to automatically check answers after input? Do you want it to be case sensitive so the answer has to be exactly the way that you put it? Do you want them to require that all the fields be answered before a solution can be viewed? Excuse me. Confirmation dialogue on check, right? If you select the automatically check answers after input, this option is not compatible. And then this is actually right here, one of the most important ones, accept minor spelling errors. So if this is activated, you have, excuse me, an answer will also count as correct with minor spelling errors. So if your answer is 3 to 9 characters, they get 1 spelling error. If it's more than 9 characters, they get 2. And that really depends on, again, the purpose of what you're asking or using this tool for. What is the pedagogical purpose? So really think about those decisions. Does it need to be exact? And then over here for text overrides and translations, this right here, anytime it says text overrides and translations, it is related to accessibility because the accessibility is built into these tools. So anytime accessibility is built in, you certainly don't want to mess with it if at all possible. So essentially just leave this alone because it's already created for you. All of that information is already added for you. And then again, all of this information down here is the same. So when you see the dialogue card, right, I'm going to spell this one wrong, really wrong. And then I'm going to spell this one right, hopefully. And then I'm going to spell this one by 1. And then I get to check my answer and it says, are you sure you want to finish? Yes, I'm sure. Well, I got this one wrong because I murdered Tallahassee, but I still got Montgomery right because it was only 1 off. And I said that you could miss by 1 character. And it gives me the, do you want to retry? Retry again. And what's great about these kinds of questions is even though you don't necessarily connect them to the gradebook, if you want to know that students are engaging with them and how they're doing, you click the reports button and it's going to tell you every person who's engaged with activity, how many times they've engaged with it, what their first, last, and best score are. So you're still able to see if students are engaging, how they're engaging and how they're doing without actually having to connect it to the gradebook so that students have that freedom to fail. Because oftentimes they have anxiety because so many things are graded in that gradebook. So if you give them the opportunity to still miss things, it gives them that freedom to say, oh, this really is for practice. This is to help me get better. And that's where you can see that information. The difference with this one is you can add images to these questions. We're not going through that long explanation because again, it's a long explanation. You didn't necessarily come prepared with images, but the thing about adding images is you just have to remember to add alt text to any image that you put in, and it's going to ask you to do that. So for this particular fill in the blank, it's important that the exact years be correct so they don't have the option of missing by 1 year. It was actually copyrighted in 1960. But this, I wanted to give you the, to be able to see what it looks like to show solution. If you want to give that option to the student, you can do that. And then they can retry again. So I've kind of trying to walk through these things quickly. So any questions about this as I give you a minute or two to maybe create it, fill in the blank with words. And is anyone willing to share where they might see this useful in their course?
I think several of these may come in handy. I've been looking for a way to address nursing, the main nursing course I teach, didactic, to review pathophysiology without taking up class time. So I think this might come in handy.
Absolutely. Thanks for sharing, Katie. Anyone else have any ideas or want to share? Or any questions?
I just wanted to add a point. Jim just asked about this in terms of phones and tablets and other mobile devices. This is very, very user-friendly for different types of devices because it scales to the size of the device better than most of the other things. D2L does it, but this within D2L does it even better. So it really helps with that aspect if your student is using a device, which also kind of opens up some opportunities for them to do class while they're on their phone in a way that helps them really connect with the material.
Thank you. So in the interest of time, I'm going to go on to the next thing. And the next thing are dialogue cards. I'm going to say, I feel like there's some pretty obvious uses for dialogue cards. And you can make dialogue cards in multiple ways. You can make dialogue cards that are text only, right? So one text on one side, text on the other. You can make dialogue cards that have audio. So I'm going to play this audio real quick and give them a hint about what the answer is. So if you turn that over, that's the theme song to Benson. Don't know if any of you remember Benson.
Unfortunately, Terry, your audio is not coming through.
Is it not coming through? Darn. Kim told me about that too. Now I just have to remember where. I don't remember where it was. Video settings.
Usually it's on the toolbar. You got to share the computer sound.
When you click screen share, it's one of the buttons on screen share.
When you go to your screen,
there we go. There we go.
Try again.
Y'all hear it? Right? No cookie cutter buddy cop TV show. If anybody wants to guess what that is while y'all are working. It's actually Chips.
Jim got it in the chat.
Did he? One last classic one. Don't. Right. Please tell me there's some 80s, 90s teens out there that know what that is. So you can add, the whole point is you can add audio. So how might want you want to add audio? Maybe you are talking about periods of time of music and you want to have clips or examples of that music, or maybe particular composers. Or maybe you want to ask students questions in the dialogue cards. you can do that. You can create a short little audio of yourself and upload that. So that actually increases your engagement with students because they're hearing you. So that's a way you could use that. You can also have images in dialogue cards. So these are fun statistical formulas, because we all love statistics, that explain, if you flip them over, what the test is and what it's used for and how often it's used or the uses for it. So these are all things that you can do within dialogue cards, but we stuck to text because it's the simplest. So, but we wanted you to be exposed and think about all the different ways you possibly could use dialogue cards whenever you're creating them. So again, if you create new content and you go to dialogue cards, again, you have to give it a name, and it's this task description. This is usually all set for you, so we leave the modes the same. And when you want to add dialogues, I have several here, but you click on the add dialogue button, and it's going to ask you for that text and for that answer. So the first part of the dialogue card means the top, second part of the dialogue card means the bottom. This is where you can add images, and you do have to add alternative text for those images, as well as audio files. So you do that for each dialogue card. You keep adding dialogue cards by adding this button so you can go through and create multiple dialogue cards. If you want them in a particular order, you can also click these arrows and move them up, move them down, however you need to, and you can keep adding as many as you want to add. Again, with behavioral setting, when it comes to tips, again, that's a pedagogical decision as a faculty member. Do you want to give tips to your students with these dialogue cards? If you do, this is where you put that information in. And then behavioral settings. Do you want them to be able to retry? Do you want to scale the text to fit inside the card, which we definitely recommend? Do you want to randomize the cards? Or do you want to disable backwards navigation, which we will say as an online ID team, we recommend never saying that students can't move backwards and forwards in an online environment with what you're doing, because students can in a face-to-face environment. So we always say to leave the ability to move backwards and forwards on. And again, we're back down to that same information that's in everyone and the text and overrides, which has to do with accessibility. So please don't fix it. Any questions about dialogue cards? As y'all are kind of hopefully building in the background things. Here is a little tidbit while you're building too. When you look at your completed whatever content, you'll see this little button at the bottom that says reuse. If you ever want to reuse the exact same thing, whether it's a format, or whether it's the exact same wording, maybe you have dialogue cards that you want to use in multiple classes because the concepts or whatever it is apply in multiple classes, you can hit this reuse button. And I say, I want to copy this content. And then when I go to create something new, I can click this little paste button. And it's literally just made that exact same dialogue cards. And you could just go in and edit them if you wanted to. Or like I said, if you have multiple dialogue cards that could be used in several classes, that's a quick and easy way to copy, and you would just save it and that's it. Any questions out there? Things I'm missing?
Tara, is that the same way the templates you're talking about would work? We go copy and follow that same process.
Yep.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. We're all about sharing here. There's no point in reinventing the wheel if you can have a wheel to start with and it just needs the lug nuts tightened or something. Again, just going to give you a couple minutes and then we're going to go over drag and drop. Does anybody want to recommend or have suggestions for how to use dialogue cards or how they might want to use them in their class?
Joan posted a great example in the chat for language vocabulary and how that could be really helpful for students when learning a new language. Thanks, Joan.
Right. It would be fantastic to hear Joan go cuckoo in an audio dialogue card. Thanks for sharing, Joan. Any other suggestions?
I teach a graduate assessment course for learning disabilities assessment, but most of the time, the age range that I've got of students, they've never been directly taught phonics. So I have to do like these little mini phonics lessons and phonemic awareness lessons. And so I have built into D2L some little practice quizzes that are not for a grade where they have to identify that. But if I could say the, because that's what happens to them, they have to say the word to the child and then the child responds back how many sounds they hear or that kind of thing. But I could do these dialogue cards for them to practice that first so that they could see the answer and then maybe then go take the practice quiz after they've gone through these.
Absolutely. Yes, because a great way to use, while y'all are kind of working, a great way to use these items too is you can put release conditions on your quizzes or on your summative assessments that say you must have engaged with these items. Now, we know that if a student clicks on it, it's going to be considered engaged as part of the course release, but you're still going to have that report data in the background. If it is something that could include an assessment, you're going to have the who engaged with it. How many times did they engage when it, what was a best or last score? So you'll be able to find out a little more information too, as far as that goes. Any other questions, ideas, suggestions, comments? All right, well then I'm gonna go ahead and go to the drag and drop. I feel like I should have a dragon with tears. As often as I say drag and drop, it sounds like that's what I'm saying. Anyway, so you can have drag and drops, either using just text or again, using images and text. So we're gonna start with just text because just text is easier. And so again, you would go into content, select that new add new content and select drag and drop. Of course, you want to give your activity that name just like every single time. And I'm going to skip down to here just so you know, again, all of this information is exactly the same. Text overrides. We want to leave it alone. We have this feedback for defined score range, just like we did in fill in the blank. It's the exact same thing. So if you want to give students the opportunity to have feedback when they fit into particular categories of ranges, you can do so. So how this works is you have a step one and a step two. Step one is if you want to add a background image to use for your drag and drop task. If you do not have a background image, then it looks like what you just saw a minute ago. If you do, then there's just going to be an image behind it. It's completely optional and up to you. You just have to remember if you're adding an image, you're adding alt text to that image. Step two is actually where you're going to build the drag and drop. So the first thing that you want to do is you want to add your drop zones, which is this little bullseye right here. So if you want to add, there are three drop zones here. That's what these are. But I'm going to click it so you can see it's going to ask for a label. What is the label for this particular zone? So we're just going to call it series one. In show label, do you want the students to be able to see the label for that particular drop zone? Well, if you're using text, then yes, you want to be able to show the label. Otherwise, they don't know what the different boxes and containers mean. Do you want the drop zone to only contain one element, meaning only one answer can be put in that particular drop zone? Again, that's completely up to the purpose of you using them and what the pedagogical purposes are behind choosing this particular tool to convey the information you want to convey or practice the information or reach the goal that you're trying to reach. And then enable auto align. If there's draggables in a drop zone, it's automatically going to align them. I'm an OCD girl, so I'm definitely going to do the enable auto align. And then I'm going to hit done. And here is this series one drop zone that I just created that then you can make bigger, you can make smaller, whatever you need to do. If you want to make them all the same size, because again, I'm an OCD girl, you click this button right here, and whatever this size is, you can type that size into every single one of them directly. So like these are all the same, but because I just created this one, it's a little different, but I could go in and I could say, okay, it needs to be whatever it was by 139, because that's the number I remember, and hit enter, and it's going to be the same size. So that's how you create a drop zone. If you create one you didn't mean to, you can click remove. If you want to copy drop zones, you can copy them and paste them. So here are my drop zones. So next, you have your drop zones. Well, now you need to create the tasks that go in those drop zones. So to create the tasks, if it is a text task, you select this button. If it is an image task, you select this button. Again, for the purposes of the workshop and time, we did everything with text and showing you the one with the image. But again, it's pretty straightforward. You just upload the image and you have to give the image all text. So if you want to create a draggable, as they call it, that's text, you click this button, you say, I'm just going to call it draggable because that's quick, and select the drop zone. So do you want it to be available for all drop zones? Do you only want it to be available for one drop zone? And again, that really goes back to what is the purpose of this activity that you are having students do. And remember too, just as the dynamic boxes before, this is a dynamic box, so you can make it a color, you can, you know, make the font bigger, you can bold it, all those kinds of things. So tell it, I'm going to say all, in the interest of time, all drop zones, and select done. And now this draggable is able to be dragged into any drop zone. Excuse me. And you would repeat that process over and over. You can copy them and say, I want to copy this one. And then I'm going to, thought I was going to paste it. There it is. Paste it. And then you can just go right in and edit that. It's not a draggable anymore. It's a draggable, because I'm making up words today. And you hit done, and now you have another one, right? So you've set up all of your, you've set up your drop zones, and you've set up your draggables. If you wanted to have this feedback range, you've set that up. So now you have to go to behavioral settings. And again, this enable retry is in everyone. Do you want the users to input before a solution can be viewed? It would seem that's pretty typical. Again, do you want to give 1 point for the whole task, meaning they get 1 point if they get everything correct or not? Or do you want it to be worth however many points of draggables you've had? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this would be worth up to 9 points if I didn't choose the give 1 point for the whole task. Apply penalties means, are you penalizing for putting wrong things in wrong zones? Enable score explanation. If you have the apply penalties button checked, it'll tell the student which ones they missed and what that score looks like. Drop zone highlighting. This really goes, this is kind of the drag and drops version of hint. If you allow drop zone highlighting always or when dragging, it actually highlights it enough. It might just be a little frame around the answer, but it kind of gives them the answer. So again, depending on what your pedagogical purposes are, is whether or not you'd want to do this. We recommend never, because well, we just don't want you to get any kind of inkling or hint for the purposes of what we're using it for. But again, that might not be the case for you. If you want to show score points, and if you want to show the title, and again, this is about accessibility. So I'm going to save this, and now you can see I'm going to start dragging things. You can definitely make your boxes bigger. Again, I didn't do that just because I was in the interest of time. And look, oh, I did horribly. See, this is where you can show the scoring. This is where it tells them what's wrong and what's not. You can hit the retry button and say, try again, and then allow them to do it again. So that's what it looks like with text. Text, this one is a little bit more to work through, because you have the different tasks. You have to make the drop zones. You have to make the draggables. And that is what they're called, drop zones and draggables. And again, if you don't want to connect something like this to the gradebook, but you want students to engage with it, you can look at that reports button and see how many attempts, the first score, last score, best score, et cetera. And then lastly, if you want to see one that with images, this is what you can do with images. So this was learning about currency. And this one jumps out because, well, there's green on this one. So students literally drag and drop to the right things. And if it's not the right thing, it's like, try again for this particular option because of the way that it was set up. If it's set up so that they can put wrong answers and wrong things, that's different. But that's really, again, thinking about the how many draggables do you want? What draggables do you want to go to which zones? Do they have the option to choose any zone? Thinking about those kinds of answers to questions. But we wanted you to see the capabilities with images because you can do both. What kind of questions might you have about this? Or ideas for use or suggestions willing to share?
Tara, if you didn't want to assign a grade, could you tie this to badges that they could earn?
That's a good question. Scott, Kim, do you know if they could be tied? I would assume they could be, but then again, I'm making assumptions about D2L is scary. So do either of you have input about that?
I'm not sure if you can make it auto assign a badge. I mean, you can create it and just have it assigned to 0 points. So then you would get notification that they had completed it to whatever level you would want them to create it or to finish it to. And then you could award a badge that way.
Thanks, Scott. Good question.
Tara, there's a question in chat about replacing, can everything be connected to grades in D2L, and wanting if you wanted to use H5P to replace quizzes, you want to talk a little bit more about that philosophy?
Yes, everything can be connected to the gradebook in this LTI settings down here. It doesn't matter what kind of activity it is, as long as it's an activity that's an accessible, assessment type activity, not a straight up activity, say like an accordion. Yes, you can send first, last, or best attempt to the gradebook. Yes, you can use H5P for quizzes, but we actually think H5P is more useful for these types of activities and using them for formative assessments rather than summative, and continuing to use the quiz tool within D2L for the actual summative. So say, for example, you want students to have practice quizzes. You could totally use this for practice quizzes and not tie it to the grade book, but still be able to say, okay, I want you to be able to aim for a certain score before you go take your test. And you could look at reports and see what students are doing. And we will talk about quizzes as part of our series eventually. We are really trying to start with the activities actually that are the easiest to create so we can get more information out there and hopefully get more faculty just getting comfortable with using H5P before we move to the more complicated, not that quizzes are extremely complicated, but to the more complicated items within H5P. But we will have a series dedicated to quizzes, but we still believe that the quiz tool within D2L is actually the better tool to use for that summative assessment that goes to the gradebook. What other questions? It's getting close to time. So I really hope that y'all were able to build some things, and there's going to be a survey, of course, as there is every time, that comes out about this. And please take the time to fill out that survey. This is the first one in the series, so we definitely want your feedback about what we could do better, what you liked, what tools you would like to see next, because we are going to listen to that feedback as we continue to determine which tools we're going to tackle next. And also too, one idea is if you have ideas about, you know, hey, can we do breakout rooms? That's something we're considering next time for faculty to work out in groups. Would y'all appreciate that within these? So please give us that feedback as well, because it's real important to us. I'm going to stop my sharing now. What other, are there any other kinds of questions that you all just might have? I'm also going to stop recording.